especially. Okay, without further ado, Hoda will introduce today's speaker.
Thank you all for coming, and thank you, Shaden Tageldin, for bringing such lovely weather from Minnesota. Shaden is an associate professor of cultural studies and comparative literature, as well as the director of African studies at the University of Minnesota. She is the author of Disarming Words, Empire and the Seductions of Translation in Egypt, published in 2011 by the University of California Press. The book was awarded an honorable mention for the Harry Levine Prize of the ACLA. Her articles have appeared in Comparative Literature Studies, International Journal of Middle East Studies, the Journal of Arabic Literature, Journal of Historical Sociology, Philological Encounters, PMLA, and other journals and edited volumes. She received the Interdisciplinary 19th Century Studies Essay Prize for her essay, Secularizing Islam, Carlisle Sadai, and the Translations of Religion in British Egypt, which appeared in the 2011 issue of the PMLA. The recipient of a Frederick Burkhardt Residential Fellowship for recently tenured scholars from the ACLS, she is currently completing a book provisionally titled Toward a Transcontinental Theory of Modern Comparative Literature, Crossing European and Ottoman Imperial Frames and Literary as well as Theoretical Discourses Across Arabic, English, and French. The project debunks Eurocentric histories of comparative literature, arguing that the long 19th century transcontinental struggle to make language and life mutually translatable informed ideologies of comparability that underpin the modern discipline. Please join me in thanking her.
Thank you very much, Hoda, for that kind introduction, and thank you, Jonathan, for the warm welcome. And thank all of you, thanks to all of you for coming today. It's wonderful to see such a warm and robust audience. I would like to reiterate my thanks first to Hoda Shekri for inviting me to Penn State, to Devin Johnson for facilitating my travel here, and above all to the Department of Comparative Literature, and I understand also the Center for Global Studies for sponsoring this talk. I'm grateful to all of you for your warm welcome and your hospitality. So the title of my paper today, my presentation today, is Beyond Latinity, Can the Vernacular Speak? South-South Literary Comparison and the Foreignness of the Vernacular. And it's part of a larger book project that Hoda just limned briefly in her introduction now, that explores and interrogates the epistemic conditions of possibility that permit the emergence of modern comparative literature. Insofar as the vernacular became, over the long 19th century, intimately bound up with the presumed life of a language, hence also with the historicity, modernity, and comparability of that language, the consolidation of the notion of the vernacular is one such condition of possibility that enables the emergence of what we think of as modern comparative literature. And that problem begs a critical question. Does the Latinate term vernacular adequately capture non-Europhone relationships of speech to writing? As comparative literary and cultural studies in the United States move toward comparatisms of the global South, the exchange value of the vernacular is rising. I suspect in part that the fortunes of the vernacular have to do with a problem that haunts all comparison, namely, how to find common ground among far-flung contexts, in this case, a common ground between Africa and Asia, beyond Bildung and Bandung, that might enable comparisons between these. So let me gloss that. To this problem, the vernacular seems to offer a solution, a ground for South-South comparisons beyond Bildung on the one hand, and what I mean by that is the influence of modern European notions of civilization, cultivation, progress, and development through education on Souths beyond Europe, and beyond Bandung on the other, and what I mean by that is the geopolitics of empire, anti-colonialism, decolonization, and post-colonialism that underwrote the South-South comparatisms and solidarities of the first Asian-African conference in 1955, which, while vitally important, are sometimes inadequate to the linguistic and aesthetic dimensions of creative expression. They don't always encompass that sphere. Yet we comparatists, attuned as we are to problems of translation, often don't recognize that the vernacular itself should not be taken for the fundamentally translatable concept it presently seems. Contemporary scholars of the vernacular in the global south tend, in the main, to embrace the vernacular as a synonym for what remains resistantly local. Here the local is opposed, on the one hand, to the hegemonies of standard or official languages of the post-independence and at times neo-colonial state, as well as the hegemonies of elite literary, intellectual, and religious or sacral discourses. On the other hand, the local is opposed to the transnational impulses of contemporary post-colonial studies, often said, not without justice, to be more interested in languages that cross national, regional, and continental lines than in those that remain somewhat more resolutely attached to local contexts. The vernacular is imagined to be, in effect, the purest expression of, if not nativity, certainly naturalness, if not secularity, surely desacralization, and above all, anti-colonialism, anti-hegemony, and democracy in both its liberal and its more radical senses. Yet the vernacular, as we know, has a history, both the cultural and intellectual history in which the English term, like some of its European language analogs, is inscribed, and the linguistic history it carries in its etymology. In Europe, the vernacular historically describes the many languages descended from Latin, originally spoken rather than written, that would come with the advent of the Renaissance and the Reformation to be more dominant languages of writing in the Catholic and the Protestant worlds, and as such supersede Latin to varying extents, obviously in different contexts, as languages of learning and at times also of religion. To invoke the term outside Europe, and to do so uniformly, as if it can represent the many non-equivalent terms it is imagined to encompass, is to impose, tacitly or not, a chain of historical necessities that a culture need undergo vernacularization if it is to undergo first a Renaissance, possibly a Reformation, then an Enlightenment, and finally become, like Europe, modern. Indeed, Gang Zhu has noted the pressure that Western logics of vernacularization exerted on other literary modernities, especially those emerging at points east and south, from Russia to China to India to Turkey during the 19th and early 20th centuries. The cultural and intellectual history of the vernacular in Europe and in its migrations as an idea outside Europe entail, more often than not, a judgment on language and on history both. I turn now to etymology, briefly. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, the English word vernacular hails from the Latin vernaculus, domestic, native, indigenous, which in turn derives from the Latin verna, a home-born slave. One definition of vernacular, tagged as rare, yet recalling the word's etymological roots, reads thus, of a slave, that is, born on his master's estate, home-born. This usage of the word, indeed, was last attested in 1804, interestingly the very year in which the Haitian Revolution successfully overthrew French colonial dominion and its regimes of slavery and instituted, although not immediately, the first independent black republic in the Western Hemisphere. So with the first great death of modern imperialism and slavery died, it seems, the colonial burdens of the vernacular. We began to forget them. In Flesh and Fish Blood, Subramanian Shankar justly argues that postcolonial theory privileges the transnational at the expense of the vernacular. By contrast to the transnational, which emphasizes the hybrid, the vernacular claims degrees of cultural autonomy, in Shankar's words, in the face of the transnational and the pressures of globalization, and indeed of translation itself, while remaining porous to relations with other languages and cultures. One way to understand the simultaneous autonomy and porosity of the vernacular, Shankar suggests, is to recognize the paradoxical position that the vernacular occupies vis-a-vis translatability. It at once cries out for translation and resists translation. While the vernacular, for Shankar, most often tends toward the untranslatable, read autonomy, it also incarnates the possibility, and here we can read porosity, that, quote, what might appear untranslatable at a given time, at a certain place, to a particular translator, might become amenable to translation over a period of time, As languages share, struggle, adjust to one another, dominate one another, educate one another through the processes of social translation, end of quote. Thus, the vernacular redefines untranslatability, in Shankar's view, as, quote, a historically contingent difficulty rather than an extra-historical, natural impossibility inherent in language. Shankar's reading is provocative, and there's much that I find really fertile and productive in it. Still, in opposing the vernacular to post-colonialism, he overrides the fact that ideologies of the vernacular are as deeply entwined with imperialism as are those of English and other languages of colonization and post-colonial transnationalism. I ask, can we really oppose the colonial to the vernacular? Can we ally the paradox of its Latin root in Verna, a homeborn slave? Its archaic English definition, or now archaic English definition, as a slave born on his master's estate. Isn't the local that underpins Verna profoundly other? For the concept of home here is to invoke Freud, unheimlich, uncanny, unhomed in many ways. It unmasks as colonized and enslaved, or at least born within regimes of empire, a mode of language that emerging US academic comparatisms of the global South would have us understand as freely native and fundamentally anti-colonial, emancipatory, and revolutionary. Might we then reconsider the vernacular in global Southern perspective beyond Latinity, sound out its comparability anew? Indeed, the very descent of the English term vernacular from the Latin verna inscribes vernacular language in a specific relation to land, personhood, property, and home that may not translate easily across the languages of the global South. Let me cite one example from the long historical case of South Asia, where, as Sheldon Pollock has argued, in the language of the gods and the world of men, one can identify at least two broad waves of vernacularization. The first, an ancient devolution of Sanskrit into the many vernaculars derived therefrom. The second, an effort beginning in the late 19th century and often under the pressures of English colonial modernity to desacralize these vernacular, to declassicize, excuse me, and also to desacralize in some cases these vernaculars, many of which by then had assumed, as Shankar also points out, the status of classical languages of writing, and to produce plainer spoken, more colloquial, or more natural versions thereof. Apart from the fact that that two-step process of what Pollock calls vernacularization uncovers both an earlier axis, somewhat analogous, although not directly equivalent, to the relationship of Latin to the European vernaculars, and a later axis in which a specifically colonial valence of vernacular ideology obtains, the supposed translatability of South Asian languages into what European discourses call vernaculars founders on a different logic of place. Citing the view of a 10th century Christian poet who argued, Western European, if I may use that anachronism, Christian poet, who argued that a language makes a people, Pollock contrasts a South Asian perspective. And I quote, if we take seriously the term for the vernacular, desa basha, language of place, then we must conclude it was far more often region that made a language and a people than the reverse. In Europe, by contrast, language names reflect reflect facts of biology and ethnology and so belong to peoples, like French, the language of the Franks, or English, the language of the Angles. End quote. Specific topographies, Pollock argues, cultivated land of black soil, sandalwood mountains, mark the South Asian languages, Kannada, Malayalam, and so forth, folded under the banner Desa Basha, language of place, rather than the relations of personhood to property inscribed in Verna and transmuted into the later senses of a native, indigenous, and natural that the vernacular would come to acquire in English. To translate Desa Basha as vernacular, then, is to erase the important and quite different nuances that attach to each term. A different problem emerges as we move from European languages across Chinese and Arabic. In tracing the modern Chinese vernacular in transnational literature, Gang Zhou identifies, quote, a crucial phase in Chinese literary history, roughly from 1895 to 1925, when China witnessed a dramatic linguistic upheaval, the rise of Baihua, literally plain speech, also called the vernacular, and the fall of Wenyan, literally refined language, also called classical Chinese, End of quote. Tracing the ideological underpinnings of this shift to Dante's defense of the vernacular in De Vulgari Eloquentia, on eloquence in the vernacular, which was written between 1302 and 1305, Joux notes that Dante had defined, quote, the vernacular as what infants acquire from those around them when they first begin to distinguish sounds, in contrast to the artificial languages such as Greek and Latin, yet sought a vernacular illustre, or in Dante's terms, a vulgare illustre, that was nothing simple and natural, but the one and only perfect language that belongs to every city, but seems to belong to none, and by which all the municipal vernaculars are weighed, measured, and compared. And so this piece right here is Dante, Joe quoting Dante, or a translation of Dante. The implications of Joe's argument are twofold. First, that the vernacular self-presents as natural because it is tied intimately in Dante's conception to speech. And second, that the vernacular aspires to be the very standard it displaces, right? To be the abstraction that makes it possible to compare those languages it reduces in turn to local reach, to municipal vernaculars. Comparing Arabic with Chinese and the many other extra-European languages that underwent social engineering during the modern period, Joux concedes that Arabic too faced the pressures of vernacularization, yet somehow, in her view, remained immune, unlike Chinese, to those pressures. Arabic, she maintains, survived in classical form. In mapping a European notion of the vernacular, tacitly equated with spoken language and thus with the colloquial, onto the third language that modern Chinese developed between the 1890s and the 1920s, Joux possibly misses the structural closeness to Baihua of the modern standard Arabic that emerged between the mid-19th and the early 20th centuries in the Afro-Asian hinge that stretched from Egypt through what was then Greater Syria as the dominant language of Arabic letters. Baihua, or modern written Chinese, was based on the Beijing Mandarin dialect, thus immediately alien to all Chinese language writers who did not speak that dialect, yet grammatically regulated so that it would not lapse into a fully colloquial mode, thus at least partially alien even to speakers of Beijing Mandarin. In its modern standard form, Arabic, written Arabic, Fusha, similarly was stripped of the complex rhetoric and syntax of its classical antecedents. They were pared down to approximate the plain spokenness of the colloquial, yet both lexically and grammatically alienated, nonetheless, from spoken dialects. Many Arabic-speaking intellectuals of the 19th century and early 20th century, even the relatively rare figure who actually published in the colloquial, refused the separation of the classical and the vernacular that underpins European logics of vernacularization by holding fast to grammar as a condition of writing. Indeed, the case of Ammiya, the Arabic term usually thought to translate vernacular, pointedly suggests that the Latinate term vernacular may not adequately capture non-Europhone relationships of speech to writing, that the nativeness the vernacular embodies may be foreign. As we have seen, the English term vernacular bears the etymological resonances of the Latin verna, and thus of a kind of a privileged subalternity, the slave born on the master's estate. It's an odd construction. Less bound, Ammiya derives from al-amma, the masses, opposed to al-khassa, the elite. Arab grammarians of the 9th to 10th centuries, as the scholar Charles Pellet suggests, began to associate the amma, the masses, with lahn, or infelicities, that contravened emerging norms of grammar. Still, such errors did not yet demarcate dialect as such against standard language, nor were they resolutely the province of the masses. The grammarians often chided the elites for committing similar errors, attesting to the fluidity of language across register and also, to a certain extent, across class. I will focus now on a reading that dramatizes this point. From long 9th century Arab-Islamic theorists who understood the languages of the masses and the languages of the elite as shades of one Arabic, converging at an ideal midpoint, or who define the masses as a social class between the low, the so-called low, and the so-called elite, and implied the same of dialectal Arabic as a linguistic register. I will trace an arc to the long 19th century Algerian interpreter Mohammed bin Braham, who argued the derivation of Ammiya dialect from Fusha, standard language, by marking the grammatical regularity of the phonetic shifts between these two registers. I suggest that a long of suppressed imagination in Arabic of continuity between dialect and standard opens horizons of relation between speech and writing, between variations and systems of the tongue, different from those the vernacular may have ushered into Europhone contexts. In an important chapter of El Bayan with Tabyin on eloquence and making eloquent, the 9th century Arab polymath Al-Jahiz explores the relationship between the registers of Arabic that later would be indexed under Fusha, standard, and Ammiya dialect. He does so through a dialogue with his contemporary, Abu Sahl Bishr ibn al-Mu'tamir al-Hilali, known as Bishr, leader of the Baghdad branch of the Mu'tazilite, or Mu'tazili in Arabic, a rationalist school of Islamic philosophy, and the exponent of a theology that maintained the radical separation of human will from divine will. So Bishr is specifically situated here. In that dialogue, Bishr rejects the equation of eloquence with complex expression. This is 9th century. Such, he believes, obstructs meaning. What the writer or speaker should seek instead is the word at once light on the tongue and easy on the understanding. Here, the quintessence of eloquence is the lucid word, lafth, that makes meaning, ma'na, equally clear, indeed transparent. Hence Bishr's crowning advice to his interlocutors, be they orators or writers or both. And I quote, such also applies to the colloquial and the elite word, or the dialectal and the elite word. And he uses the terms al-ammi wal-khassi. For if you can attain clarity of tongue, eloquence of pen, delicacy in how you broach a subject, and power over your ego, such that you make the masses understand the meanings of the elite and clothe those meanings in average words, neither too refined to be understood by the masses, nor too harsh to be appreciated by the competent, then you are the paragon of eloquence, end quote. Notice that Bishr constructs ideal language, here ideal Arabic, as a midpoint on a continuum. While he later concedes that the average word is not always the best word in a given text, he notes that the sublimity or precision of lofty or erudite language, even jargon, even specialized language, has its place sometimes, just as the zest of common language, however trivial or crude it may be, also has its place, clearly, in certain contexts. He generally subscribes to the golden mean. Right? Yes, context determines the right mode of expression. Bishr insists that one must match al-maqal, locution, to al-maqam, occasion. Yet meaning itself, interestingly, does not discriminate. In his view, it is a core essence fundamentally shared. And I quote, meaning does not rise to the level of the elite, al-khassa, nor does it reduce itself to the level of the masses, al-amma, end quote. Often then, the best signifier is that which best evokes the common denominator of meaning, which for Bishr is the great sociolinguistic equalizer. Thus, the articulation of meaning need not in the main discriminate between dialectal or colloquial and literary Arabics. For in most contexts, Bishr concludes, signifiers too can be chosen from a rhetorical middle ground, al-fad al-wasita is the term he uses, that appeals to the masses, al-amma, and the elite, al-khassa, or learned, al-akfa, alike, alienating no one. In the making is a register somewhat akin to what Dante would much later call a vulgare illustre, or illustrious vernacular belonging to all in belonging to none. Al-Jahiz's response to Bishr is telling. He concurs with the latter's definition of eloquence and goes on to clarify that by al-awam, which like al-amma also denotes the masses, he does not intend the peasants and the artisans and the merchants, the peasants and the lowly, nor foreign or so-called barbarian peoples living within the Arab-Islamic imperium. Rather, the masses who share our creed and those whom we hope to convert, and who share our language and our literature, edebina, and our mores, constitute the stratum whose minds and mores are above those peoples, though it has not reached the rank of our elite." End quote. In Bishr's analysis, al-amma, the masses, anchor one end of a sociolinguistic continuum, al-khasa, the elite, the other. Al-Jahiz refashions the masses in the image of Bishr's ideal language, reinventing it, we could say, as a social stratum, maybe an emerging broad middle class, that effectively embodies Bishr's target audience for eloquent speech and writing composed of average words. Thus, al-Jahiz turns the category of the masses itself into a zone of intermediacy, at the heart of Arabic and yet shy somehow of its purest expression. I have said that something of a vulgari illustre sounds in Bishr's conception of an ideal language. Vulgari illustre typically is translated as illustrious vernacular. Yet Bishr's is a notion closer to the vulgari, to the vulgar, a term that long denoted the common and the ordinary in European usage, European language. Parlance, than it is to the vernacular with its etymological roots in a master-slave relation. Al-Jahiz tilts Bishr's middle upward toward privilege. He insists, however, that the language of the masses, al-amma, is not to be understood in opposition to al-fusha, literary or standard Arabic, but up close to and of a piece with it, neither subaltern in the strong sense Verna might imply, nor foreign to pure Arabic as the breakaway European vernaculars later would be in their relation to Latin. This logic of continuum, rather than diglossia, between standard and vernacular, defined Arab-Islamic scholarly understandings of the relationship between Fusha and Ammiya from at least the long 9th through the long 19th centuries. 10 centuries after Al-Jahiz and his interlocutor, Bishr, the Algerian linguist Mohammed bin Braham would construct the unity of Arabic in similar terms. In 1900, bin Braham published Répartition des voyelles dans l'Arabe vulgaire, Distribution of Vowels in Dialectal Arabic, a text he had delivered in 1899 in Rome at the 12th International Congress of Orientalists. A native of Cherchel in Algeria, Ben Braham was a judicial interpreter and thus a functionary of the French colonial government in Algeria. He was also an active research orientalist, we might say, a member of the Société Asiatique de Paris. He attended several international congresses of orientalists, and he was the author of several books, this being one of them. 2 points strike us in reading Ben Braham. First, in his very choice of répartition, distribution, as the operative word in the book's title, a term often applied to distribution of wealth in this period in French, he astutely recognizes that the debates surrounding Arabic speech and Arabic writing turn on the shifting distribution of unwritten sound between economies of language, colloquial and formal, ammiya and fusha, and economies of social class, masses and elites, al-amma to al-khasa. Whereas 18th and 19th century European scholars such as Ernest Renan understood as language defect, even language death, the fact that short vowels in Arabic often went unwritten and thus unfixed, Ben Braham interprets that very non-fixity as the site of dynamism, as the space of involuntary transformation that yields dialect from literary standard. Secondly, he roundly rejects the thesis there is only one Arabic language, dubbed dialectal, whose willful transformation formed literary Arabic, and argues the reverse. There is only one Arabic language, dubbed literary, whose involuntary transformation formed dialectal Arabic. This language, he continues, is that which in pre-Islamic times was spoken by the tribes of Arabia, that of writers of prose and of poets, that of the literary monument par excellence, the Quran, as the book itself teaches us. It conserved all its primitive purity so long as the people who spoke it lived in the land that was its cradle. But later, when it found itself in contact with peoples belonging to other races, following from political or other events, that purity began to decline. End quote. Thus, Ben Braham opposes those who see in standard Arabic, Fusha, an artificial stabilization of the natural life of language that dialectal Arabic, Ammiya, represents. To say that grammarians manufactured literary Arabic from a dialectal ancestor, he contends, wrongly implies that, quote, Arabic words would have been originally indeclinable, and he's speaking here of declension. And declension would have been due to the caprice of grammarians who would have created it long after the formation of the language itself. So here what he's referring to is the fact that commonly in dialectal Arabic, things like case endings drop out, whereas in written Arabic, whether those case endings are always marked or not, they must always be observed, and they're typically in place. So nothing, he declares, could be more false. Okay, this is his categorical rejection. After the fall, perhaps, declension would be suspended in spoken, but observed in written Arabic. After the fall that Ben Braham perceives. Yet in an originary pure Arabic, in which no separation divided speech from writing, declension must have been proper, he argues, to all Arabic, for it is not superfluous but essential. Essential, he argues, to fix the grammatical positions of words in a given sentence, to tell subject from object, for instance, and thus to fix meanings that otherwise would sound or read as double entendre. As irrefutable proof, in his view, that the declension of literary Arabic is not the work of grammarians, Ben Braham cites the fact that grammatical studies were only undertaken during the time of the Caliph Ali, the fourth caliph in Sunni Islam, by which point Arabic literature already had produced its most beautiful masterpieces, including, in his words, the Quran. Grammar, in a word, for him is natural, not artificial, not imposed. Ben Braham's stress on the unity of Arabic echoes that of Bishr and Al-Jahiz. What is new, however, is his rationale for a continuum between spoken and written language. Ben Braham argues that the differences between these two forms of Arabic are at bottom metrical, thus rationally and theoretically predictable. He shows how systematic modifications of short vowels in particular instances, their silencing, voicing, or substitution of an a for an u for an e, for example, distinguish Arabic in its dialectal or spoken form from Arabic in its literary or written form. Such has been Braham's argument on the plane of poetics. Even more novel on the plane of politics is his startling ascription of democracy, which European discourse usually associates with the vernacular, to a pure Arabic in which the spoken and the written have always already, in his view, been united. All grammarians of Arabic, he writes, irrespective of time and school, were compelled to analyze the language spoken in Arabia and to highlight the particularities of the dialects of the tribe. They were, he suggests, descriptive rather than prescriptive linguists, deriving the rules of grammar from actual and popular parlance, never imposing such rules on unruly speech. Quote, if in Europe writers have managed by their writings to exercise an influence on the languages of their countries and either to contribute to their modification or to refine them, Ben Braham concludes, such has not been the case in Arabia. There it is the people and the people alone who have created and fixed the language. End quote. With one stroke, Ben Braham underscores what he sees as an originary equivalence between the so-called literary or pure or written or standard Arabic, usually called Fusha, and the dialectal or spoken Arabic, whose very name, Ammiya, so closely identifies it with Al-Amma, the masses, the people. Abolishing the distinction between standard and dialect, elites and masses, he in effect pronounces Arabic an eminently revolutionary and, in the French sense, republican language, democratic at its root. Ben Braham's arguments stand in fascinating comparison with those of the Egyptian nationalist, essayist, and newspaper editor, Abdullah Nadim, his contemporary, in his 1893 debate with the Anglo-Indian engineer Sir William Wilcox, architect of the first Aswan Dam. A devotee of Dante, Wilcox contended that Egypt had failed to progress scientifically because forced to write in what he called the artificial, dead language of classical Arabic, rather than in the natural, living idiom of Egyptian colloquial Arabic. This is where the entanglement of the vernacular with colonial ideology comes in. Writing in his popular periodical of El Usted, between 1892 and 1893, whose pages up to that point often did feature articles in the Egyptian colloquial, and Nadim exposes the fallacies of Wilcox's vision, Wilcox's assumption that written Arabic is not up to the task of modernity, of modern science, or even of modernity itself. He rejects Wilcox's vision of the life and death of language, and in so doing, insists on the modernity of standard Arabic. Against Wilcox and Nadim writes, the correct language, al-lugha sahiha, is the living, given its use by the elite and the common, bayn al-khassi wal-ammi, among the wise of the community. And the colloquial language, al-lugha darija, is the dead, given its disuse for all but the necessities that a language less animal requires. And there's a lot to unpack here. As for Ben Braham's speech exiled from grammar, which is not always tantamount to writing, but is often fixed and secured through writing, is speech exiled from the past. And that ahistoricity is, for Nadim, the ultimate corruption, collapsing the human into the non-human animal. The aliveness he imputes to correct Arabic is of a piece with its continuity with the past, its status as a culture bearer and bearer of belief, its capacity to carry time for all who use it across religious lines, and of course, in Nadim's view, to carry belief across time for Muslims, in particular, given its association with the language of the Quran. The colloquial is dead because it is an inherently presentist language, loosened from the bedrock of Arab-Islamic tradition. One third of its vocabulary, and Nadim observes, is foreign. Yet in Nadim, I should stress, is not opposed to the influence of the foreign on Arabic. His point is that standard Arabic is at once adequate to the foreign, a language into which modernity, if the foreign should be equated with modernity, is translatable, and responsible to the self, to the preservation and reinvigoration or renewal of tradition. Ben Braham's optic differs somewhat in that the continuity of the standard lies in its perpetual renewal by an involuntary consensus of the people, the users of language, over time. Still, Ben Braham's present is a perpetual past also, harking back, like in Nadim's, to pre-Islamic and early Islamic Arabia, and not the, at least imagined, ahistorical present of the European vernacular that, in the view of Ben Braham and in Nadim alike, forgets or supplants the past. Moreover, for both Ben Braham and Nadim, standard written Arabic, insofar as it traverses the educated elite, and we should assume here also the reasonably educated common, and refuses the separation of speech from writing, holds within itself the potential to cross class and to cross registers of language that Wilcox would reserve for a written Egyptian Arabic. In the end, then, we must ask, is Arabic Ammiya dialect a slave born on the master's estate of Fusha, standard? Or is the dialectal to be understood in light of the writings of Bishr, Al-Jahiz, Ben Braham, and Nadim, and others across a millennium, less as privileged subalternity and more as a kind of systematic non-systematicity, strangely regular in its irregularity? If so, perhaps Al-Ammiya should not be, dialectal Arabic, should not be translated as vernacular at all, but reinterpreted as medium, as a medium in every sense, a language at once common and pure, originary and ordinary, ordinary and originary, hence in some sense extraordinary, unruly and ruly, within and beyond system. I end by suggesting that the fortunes of the vernacular for contemporary comparatisms of the global south cannot be disarticulated from the rise of modern regimes of comparison in the shadow of 19th century imperialism. The discourses of Ben Braham and Nadim as they confront the eruption of the vernacular as a medium, yet also a comparative epistemic problem between English, French, and Arabic in this case, invite us to trouble the vexing distinctions between orality and writing, commons and elites, nature and artifice, living and dead, and native and foreign, that the resurgence of the vernacular in contemporary global southern comparatisms threatens to reify. Thank you.
Thanks so much for that rich and nuanced and yet also really lucid talk. And I guess I have to lead things off with what I think is ultimately a methodological question about translation, kind of excavating the etymology of that in light of the work you're doing with to excavate and challenge the idea of the vernacular too. So, are they okay? So I just wanted to say, thinking through the sort of epistemic shift that you trace in thinking about vernacular and the vulgar as to where they belong and how they function as media. I'm wondering if you could reflect a little bit about the idea of what gets carried in translation. Insofar as you're kind of giving this archaeology of an epistemic shift. You mentioned epistemological conditions. If the vernacular bears the trace not only of the master-slave, but also of region in some of the iterations that you were discussing, is there a way in which translation bears the regional and the spatial somewhere between an epistemological condition and a place? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it strikes me that your work is really dedicated to translating epistemological conditions somehow. And I wonder if you could reflect on that a little bit for us.
Thank you. Thank you for that wonderful question, Jonathan. Thinking about the terms in which you cast translation just now as at once an attempt to carry over epistemological conditions, but somehow to situate these in place, right? Struck by the resonance of the notion of localization. You know, when you look, for instance, at how, in particular, in the IT world, you know, software gets translated today. Often the operative term used there is localization, which is a curious one. There's a translation at work of the program, often the manuals that accompany it, an attempt to make somehow this this piece of code legible to its users, and but also in so doing to emplace it, right? To localize it. And that is obviously a very different context from the kind of context I'm talking about, but it highlights, I think, the situational aspect and the need to regionalize or localize the word in translation. To backtrack here, I think one of the things that's interesting about the translation, if we want to think of it as such, of the notion of the vernacular or the premise of the vernacular as the proper language of a modern literature across a variety of spaces, of regional spaces, in the long 19th century, is the fact that that good, that new, what is now perceived suddenly as a good and as a necessity of the modern, doesn't really go under the banner vernacular, right? Often in these new places, it may or may not, but a host of new words or old words, in the case of Amiya, an old word, are marshaled to describe what is, in some respects, a new phenomenon. And that is interesting in itself, because what we're talking about is a kind of a re-signification often of older terms in the modern moment. We're talking about a kind of an old new construction, right? That certainly is a form of cultural and epistemic translation, but may not be necessarily a lexical translation or semantic translation of a term. And in fact, I think the very recourse to old words and the resignification of old words maybe points to an attempt to situate these incoming notions of modern language in place, right? To resituate these in a different context, and I don't know if that's really getting at your question sufficiently, or if what you're trying to suggest is that topography as well as epistemology is something we need to think about. I think you had in mind the Desa Basha formulation, the language of place, how that might be transformed in its new understanding as vernacular, for instance.
And especially in contrast to sort of colonial portage, right, mm-hmm. where you sort of see the actual cityscapes and then buildings and products be sort of replicated, mm-hmm. almost a material culture of translation, really.
Yes. Yeah. No, absolutely. So, you know, the transport of colonial urban models into far-flung spaces is certainly a form of translation, if you will, architectural translation, topographic translation, and that very much accompanies this the phenomenon I'm talking about. I think one of the things that was really curious for me is how to parse how to parse the way in which writers in the Arabic context, but not only the Arabic context, in the long 19th century, are imagining certain understandings of language and literature as new, and yet very clearly pointing to the long-standing existence of similar discourses within the Arabic tradition. So why they gesture to the fact that Ibn Khaldun said something very similar, or Al-Jurjani said something very similar, you know, some 10 centuries earlier, and yet are at pains to state tacitly, and often not so tacitly, that these are ideas coming in from Europe. These are ideas that are part of the freight of modernity that writers must embrace if Arabic is to enter the fold of what I think of as comparable literature, right? And that really delicate negotiation between claiming in effect that we have always already had something like this, we've always already been modern, and yet we are not modern, is something that interested me. And I haven't thought of that perhaps in quite the terms of place within the Arabic context that you suggest, but it's not negligible. In fact, one of the texts I'm looking at by an Ottoman Palestinian intellectual, Muhammad Ruh al-Khalidi, who writes in the same period, and writes one of the earliest works on comparative literature in Arabic, looking at French and Arabic literatures in tandem, in a very different context. In his writings on what was then the kingdom of Dahomey, Benin, now Benin, speaks to the fact that it is a travesty that modern Arab writers use European place names to refer to cities in West Africa, but also in many parts of, and he points this out, in the supposed heartland of Arabic in North Africa, right, and in West Asia, when they have always had names for these places. There are prior namings that attest to Arab interaction in West African space, but also when he was talking, for instance, about Algeria and why Oran instead of Wahran, you know, he's speaking also of the erasure, even in places where in effect the Arabic writer is referring to the self, to the immediate self, not to a geography somewhat distanced from his or her own, in European terms. So place, you know, this kind of translation and transliteration of terms becomes an index in the thinking of Al-Khairidi, an index to his critique, really, of a failure to locate oneself as an agent of language, of knowledge production, of geographic interaction, of all manner of things, and to always kind of situate agency elsewhere, to locate it in Europe. And yet he's participating in this discourse. He makes many of the kinds of maneuvers we talk about here. He, you know, advocates for natural language as the precondition, really, of a modern literature, and basically calls on Arabic writers to shear away all artifice. And artifice to him is death. So he's not an innocent participant in this discourse. And also not innocent of some of the imperial valences of wanting to inscribe Arabic terms on, say, you know, West Africa. Yeah, there is a problem there too. It's a gesture of competition with Europe at that moment, and not simply a memory of a pre-colonial past.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. I don't know who's. Yeah.
Thank you so much for the talk. It was really helpful and useful in a bunch of different ways. And I wanted to ask you a question, and this is maybe just to make richer what you've already kind of talked about. And that is, you know, you kind of contrasted these two models of diglossia, where you have Latin versus French, Spanish, Italian, Portuguese, that kind of thing, and then a kind of continuum where you have Anmea Arabic and Fusa Arabic or something like that. And one of my questions then is, you know, I think in some ways a focus on Arabic maybe keeps us from seeing some other kinds of potential diglossias. I don't know if they are. For instance, how does Wolof interface with Arabic in West Africa,
right,
and so forth? My real question, though, has to do with something that might be underlying that, which is the relationship of language theory
to adjacent theories about the proper language of revelation, mm-hmm. and whether revelation is still open-ended or has been closed. Mm-hmm. One of the things that happens in Buddhist East Asia, which is where I do most of my work, is that one of the things that Buddhism decouples from the religions that become known as Hinduism is the language of revelation. And so there's sutras where the Buddha says, you know, I'll speak to birds in the language of birds and demons in the language of demons. It doesn't, you know, language doesn't matter. And that allows the sutras to then travel all throughout East Asia in a Chinese original, even though everyone knows the Buddha didn't speak Chinese, right? That strikes me as a fundamentally different notion of the palpability of language and the possibilities of language than what you have in an Arabic speaking yes. world that is tied to the Quran in yes. particular.
Yes. That's an excellent question. First of all, to address the part of your question, Charlotte, that has to do with diglossia, you're absolutely right. There tends to be a focus on certain languages, at Arabic becoming a paradigmatic example for early 19th century French and sometimes also British Orientalists, of that tendency to focus on Arabic and similarly constructed languages as particularly diglossic and to forget the operations of diglossia or multiple registers of language in other languages. And Nadim, in fact, one of the points he raises against Wilcox is that, you know, English has ceased to be this unitary language that Wilcox presents it as being. Maybe it once was a vernacular in opposition to, say, Latin. But English has now developed its own registers, right? And he contends, you know, spoken English is not written English. It is not true that the scientific texts produced in English use fundamentally the same kind of language, same register of language, and same grammar as spoken English. So this sort of argument is in fact marshaled by some thinkers of the period to say, you know, maybe all languages are diglossic or multiglossic in some way, and to move the discourse away from what is in effect an ideological and colonial critique of certain languages as being defective for being diglossic. So that speaks a little bit to the first part of your question, which is really important, and there are other valences of it, I know. The other question you raise about the language of revelation is equally, I think, an important one, because yes, in the main, I think, within an Arab-Islamic framework, the notion of the understanding of the Quran for many believing Muslims as a text that is revealed directly as the word of God in a specific Arabic makes it perhaps harder to understand Arabic as to understand the language of revelation as something malleable, open, potentially, you know, amenable to change. So even if there is an appeal to orality, that this is, you know, this is a text in a clear Arabic, and clear Arabic is understood at that time as very often the language of the Bedouin, and the earliest grammarians, they actually, when they're trying to solve disputes in 9th, 10th century, you know, Basra and, you know, present day Iraq, they would say, bring me a Bedouin. and a Bedouin would be brought in to, in effect, testify, right? So then the nomadic, you know, by that point, the nomadic Arab of Arabia is understood as the carrier of the pure, and this is a purely oral, in many respects, culture. And, you know, the city dweller, although valorized in other ways, is understood as somehow corrupted or impure because of the conglomeration of different ethnicities, races. We heard this kind of discussion here. Languages that come into major cities by the 9th century in a place like Baghdad in an imperial formation. So yeah, so the recourse to the oral is there, and therefore to kind of, if we want to think of the oral as dynamic and lived and changing in some sense, but it is used to fix the correctness, the accuracy and the purity of the language of revelation. So that is something of a stumbling block, even I think in contexts where the door of interpretation is understood as open, for instance Shiite Islam, you know, or Mu'tazili, the rationalist tradition, which also understood the door of interpretation, ijtihad, as open. There isn't always, I think, and I would have to delve into this more deeply, but there isn't an understanding necessarily of language, the language of the text, as malleable. although in the case of Shiism in particular, how it plays out in Iran, the fact that there are vernacular, as Travis Zeda would argue, vernacular translations of the Quran into Persian, as is the case in other parts, you know, other parts of the Islamic world outside the so-called Arabic heartland, that might complicate this notion if one were to rethink the issue and say, is there a correlation between an understanding of the door of interpretation as open and the dislocation of the Quranic text into a different language space where it undergoes translation and undergoes vernacularization? Is there a correlation between these things? It's a really interesting question, and one that I really thank you for helping me think more about in relation to the Buddhist example, which is just wonderful. Yeah, really wonderful.
Perhaps for the sake of time, yeah. You string together a number
yeah,
of questions.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I hope I haven't gone on too long.
Yeah.
Sorry if I've gone on too long there.
Okay. So as a Hellenist, I often get frustrated by how Greek often tends to get ossified like twice over, because it gets ossified by Latinists and then it gets ossified by later Europeans. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to think about the fact that, especially in terms of your Dr. Ebrin's idea about place and topographies, and you know, there are multiple different dialects. And when we talk about ancient Greek, we're usually talking about Attic Greek, which is based in Athens. But you know, like Herodotus didn't write in Attic Greek. And yes. There are a ton of different, and then they get synthesized. And then so Latin speakers take certain types of Greek, and they're more important. And then Koine Greek gets used for the Bible, and blah blah blah. And then Greek becomes this sort of like magical language that no one really can read or understand. But like people spoke Greek, and it's been a long time since I've read the Sheldon Pollock, but I think I remember that Sanskrit was never actually spoken. It was not like something that became, you know, synthesized to that sort of language. It was sort of like artificially created, and I don't know if I'm right about that. But so my question is, what does it mean that history sort of often gets elided or erased, and does that history matter to how we think about like a colonializing language?
Thank you so much for a really, really interesting talk. I was just trying to think about what, and this is a question that tags onto Charlotte's question about Wolof and Arabic, because I'm even more sub-Saharan African, right? So
yes, yes.
I'm trying to think about what happens when languages develop mostly oral until the colonizer comes. So I'm thinking of Swahili, Xhosa, Zulu, and so on. And what happens now where, first of all, none of these languages have ever been tied to a monotheistic tradition, which changes the picture like massively.
Yes.
So I'm trying to think of, it's not a question so much as just trying to say like what are the differences or how it would work out differently in a situation where A, you don't have that monotheism, and B, you do have a two-way borrowing system whereby people will use the Zulu word because Zulu can be very, 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 what's the word when it sounds like what it is? Zulu's the best at that.
Onomatopoeia.
Yeah, onomatopoeia. So a snake, everybody says nyam, nyam, because it's a snake, or a somersault is, you can hear it, right?
Yeah.
But then when you have to speak about things on the mines, that there's no word for it, and so then the English word comes in. But the borrowing is very bastardized. Like it doesn't go, there was an argument under the apartheid government, of course, that it only went one way, but everybody knows that's bullshit. So, right, so I'm just wondering how that changes radically the kinds of pictures of what is a vernacular.
Yes, and then Carrie?
Two quick comments from the 14th century. One is that English never was one standardized language. This is a really funny to us 14th century comment by somebody who's writing in a more southerly dialect saying, you can't understand those people up in the north.
Right.
And he's talking about the north of England. And so he's saying they're just totally mutually unintelligible, they make such weird sounds in their throats, you just can't figure out what they're talking about. The other is that Chaucer's preface to his treatise on the astrolabe, which is a translation, may level the contrast that you've been working with between what we're calling vernacular languages and what you might call learned languages, because he asserts that the material that he happens to be working on there is equally intelligible to people who use Latin, Greek, Hebrew, Arabic, which he names presumably as languages of learning, and all the other languages, and any number of other languages, and so he's now presenting that material in English, as if all the spoken languages and all the learned languages can equally contain these ideas and are translatable among one another. So the idea that the vernacular is somehow either more or less translatable than the languages of learning is something that seems to me not borne out by examples of early theory about languages.
That's tremendously helpful.
Thank you.
The reference to Chaucer, and also the reminder that English itself should not be understood as monolithic, and was not understood by its speakers in that moment as a monolithic language. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Shall I try to respond quickly or not?
Perhaps we can thank you first.
Okay, all right. Yes. Okay.
After that.
Okay, so that those who need to leave can leave. And yeah, no, I understand.
Let's make sure that we do it.
Yeah,
properly.
Yeah. Oh, that's kind of you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you all for such wonderful questions. Really generative. Really, yes. I will try to be quick for those of you who are able and kind enough to linger slightly. To address first your question about Hellenism and about Greek, the odd status of Greek. I think this is, you know, of a piece with, just as there's a tendency to, after the fact, and I'm thinking a little bit here of the work of Naoki Sakai and how we represent phenomena after the fact, Naoki Sakai in translation and subjectivity, as opposed to how those phenomena are actually lived and experienced in their moment. You know, Sakai says we represent translation, right, as a neat transfer from one self-contained language to another self-contained language, but that's never how translators and translation work. That there's always a kind of hybridity of the person, of the translator, of the languages in question, which are never self-enclosed, etc. In the actual work of translation. So similarly, I think when we think about the vernacular, I'm thinking about Carrie's comment and other comments that have surfaced about English. It gets represented later by an ideologue such as Wilcox as if it is a unitary language without its own registers in history, as if it weren't understood by its speakers at various moments as heterogeneous. It gets represented as a language in which the spoken and the written are in perfect harmony with one another, and that this is part of its engine, part of the engine of the creative and scientific progressivism of English, and therefore Egyptians need to understand and practice their own language in the same way, etc. Similarly, there's a tendency to rewrite Greek. This is in a different context, to rewrite Greek as you use the term magical, as a Western language that is no longer lived, right? That is only and thoroughly classical, and that can be marshaled, you know, as such to make certain arguments for the coherence of a Western tradition. And that is clearly a representation of Greek in the 19th century that is at odds with a reality. So what's really interesting there is that one could say that the sort of demotic or vernacular energies of Greek are elided in the interest of maintaining Greek as, strictly speaking, a classical language, and with Latin, the situation is somewhat different in that you no longer have, you know, for all intents and purposes, a community of speakers whose language resembles the Latin of ancient times in any sense enough for there to be understood as this kind of continuity, right, between a classical and a living spoken language. So there's less need, I think, to ossify and fix Latin in that way than there is in the case of Greek. So I think if I'm reading your question correctly, you're absolutely right that there's a certain fixing at work there of Greek that elides the question of vernacularity, and that this needs to come into the discussion. Your question and comment about Thank you for that as well, about Wolof Arabic, about Swahili or Zulu, languages in which the cultural context in which there's no attachment to monotheism per se, and in which there are complicated borrowings, you were saying, between the vernacular and the local pre-colonial, if we want to think of it as such, language and colonial languages such as English that come in later. It's a really important one. A couple of things I'm thinking about here. One is, you know, Simon Gikundi, for instance, in his essay Contested Grammars, talks about the conundrums of the reception of Swahili and says, you know, one of the reasons why Swahili poetry gets translated and studied by scholars in the West is that, in his argument, it hews closely to the conventions of Arabic and Persian poetries, and therefore it can be conscripted into a certain kind of Orientalist tradition. But Swahili prose is not, he said, studied sufficiently because it's, in effect, more, in his argument, more vernacular energies escape, right? Escape that that prism, that compass. And it's a very interesting.
It's a very late developing language on the continent.
Yeah, in some sense constructed too, right? Yeah. Johannes Fabian talks about that.
It's different from Zulu and
Uh-huh. Yes.
And yet it's the first one people want to study.
Yes, yeah, exactly. Exactly, which tells us maybe a lot. So I'm interested, you know, in part about how either having an excessive orality or too insufficient orality, how these two poles determine what counts or can't count in the sphere of comparability. Thank you, Carrie. Yes, thank you. I appreciate that very much. Thank you for your comment. Because Arabic is deemed insufficiently oral to enter the pale by Orientalists of the 19th century, the pale of comparability. And many other African languages are, in effect, classified as excessively oral, this, you know, and they fall out of the pale for that reason. So orality becomes a kind of a litmus test, but a very complicated one, right? A very messy one. So to think about the question of a non-monotheistic relationship to language a little bit, and also a context in which traditions were perhaps more exclusively oral, if not exclusively so, than written. I think that one of the points I'm trying to make as I develop this project is that the vernacular should not be understood as one.